Hello again.
Hello.
Okay, let's reintroduce ourselves. Yeah. I'm Dara.
I'm Erin.
And of course, we had to have a little bit of a tech difficulty because it's How to Eat Facebook Live, and that's what we do here. So thanks for coming to our virtual meal prep party.
Our inaugural. Whoop, whoop.
Yeah, we're very excited. We're going to jump right to it because it's late and we want to get it done in an hour.
Yes.
So we'll just tell you a little bit about how it's going to work. When one of us is prepping, the other one will be manning the computer, answering your questions. If we don't get to some comment, we will definitely get to it later. So please comment away. And just before we start, we have to apologize. We left the rolled oats off the grocery list. So if you can't get oats and can't make the baked oatmeal tonight, then our sincerest apologies. We owe you a baked oatmeal.
Yes, and you can always watch this video after the fact and make it tomorrow night if you go out and get your oats.
There you go.
So we're making three recipes today, right?
Yes.
We're making a vegetarian Mexican lasagna, we're making a Thai tofu curry, and we're making a baked apple peanut butter oatmeal. And then we're going to show you a few tips around how we prep for some snacks during the week.
Yeah, and we have a fun contest that Erin's going to tell you about.
Yeah, so we want to see how you meal prep, and if you go, if you take a photo of, you know, kind of anything you're doing while you're food prepping, and you tag us, which is How to Eat on Instagram, or How to Eat Blog on Facebook, we're going to be picking a winner next Monday, which is May 29th, and we'll be doing a $20 Amazon card giveaway. So show us what you do to meal prep at home, and you may be the winner.
How awesome is that?
Yeah.
Okay, let's dive in. We're going to do the baked oatmeal first because that has to bake for about 40 minutes, so we want to make sure we get that done. So first step, preheat your oven to 350. Ours, we already preheated it before. If we get to it and the oven's not up to 350, that's okay. We'll throw our baked oatmeal in and it will all be good. It will all cook. So first step, let's chop our apples. I'm going to pay attention to what I'm doing here because as Erin's husband warned me, we don't want to have an accident on camera.
Yeah.
We have a garbage bowl nearby, which is a good tip when you're cooking and prepping things. It kind of just makes things go smoother. You get rid of the garbage right away.
So like you see Daryl prep a little bit.
Yes.
Nice sharp knife is the name of the game when you're prepping vegetables and fruit. I usually, not sharpen, but I use this little tool here. It's called a honer. And it doesn't actually sharpen your knife, but it straightens the knife edge. So it allows you, so in essence, it kind of feels like it's sharpened because it's a lot easier to cut once your edge is really straight.
I don't have one of those. You could, if you don't have apples, you don't like apples, you could also substitute pears in this recipe. It would be great.
Yeah.
Same thing for the peanut butter we're going to use. You could use any nut butter you have on hand, or you're trying to keep it nut-free if it's going to school for a snack. You could use sunflower butter or wow butter would probably work in this too.
My husband is escaping upstairs now because the moment we pressed play on the live video, my daughter woke up and started crying in the crib upstairs. So she hasn't settled and is going to go upstairs and do his job.
Okay, so the apples, we just put them aside there. We're going to get started on our dry ingredients first. So it's kind of like a classic baking. Any baking recipe. We're going to do dry and then wet and then add wet to dry. So you need 4 cups of oats. Again, sorry about that one. So we're using the rolled oats here. You wouldn't want to use the quick cooking oats. It would change the texture of the oatmeal dish.
These stand up a little bit better. Mm-hmm. It's basically a whole grain oat that has just been flattened in processing. But they maintain that kind of chewy, satisfying texture.
When you go through the blog recipes, there's a bunch of baked oatmeal and snacks, and you know, those are all mine.
They're all theirs.
Yeah. I kind of love my baked oatmeal. It's really delicious.
Well, we have like different fortes.
Yeah.
Right? Like, we're looking through, we have like about 300 blog recipes now, and we were looking through them all, and I do all of the seasonal recipes. So, like, when asparagus comes in the season, when rhubarb comes in the season, which is now.
And check out our last post was our top 10 spring recipes. Delicious.
Yeah.
And I think only one was my original recipe.
Yeah, see? I do all the seasonal stuff. Yeah. You do all the oatmeals and the cookies and the baked stuff.
The delicious stuff.
We have Kyla Wall watching. Hi.
Okay.
Karen Dent. Wendy Lopez. Also hello. Thanks, guys.
I just added the half a cup of brown sugar. So the next we're going to do 2 teaspoons of baking powder. What's baking powder and baking soda? Like, I don't really know the exact difference. Do you, Erin?
Baking powder has some extra stuff in it. Well, they're both leavening agents.
Right.
I don't know the difference.
If you know, comment, because I'm curious.
That would be awesome.
We're going to add about a teaspoon of salt, and then 2 teaspoons of cinnamon. And you can also just, you know what, you could just like dump in
You don't have to measure.
No, you really don't. And that took me a while to kind of get away from that. Erin knows I was
a stupid measurer.
Measurer, planner, and organizer.
Yeah.
But Erin's been teaching me the ways.
Okay. Just relax.
Yeah.
That's how you learn to cook, by making mistakes and just kind of eyeballing things and just giving it a go.
Okay, so that's all mixed together. So now we got our wet ingredients. So we're using 3.5 cups. The recipe says almond milk because that's what I use at home for cereal and oatmeal. But you could use 2% whole milk, soy milk, any milk's going to work here.
Yeah, and because there's also peanut butter in the recipe, if you choose to use a low protein milk substitute like almond beverage, or if you were using what are the other ones? Rice or hemp,
cashew
or coconut
milk
or cashew.
Yeah.
None of those are a good source of protein.
We're also adding eggs, so that's
also
adding some protein.
So lots of protein in here already.
Speaking of the eggs, we're gonna add 2 eggs. Again, having that garbage bowl handy is
Jennifer Dick, who is a professional home economist and who is joining us, is helping us out with baking soda versus baking powder. Baking powder contains baking soda. So there's baking soda in baking powder.
Oh.
And sometimes cornstarch and cream of tartar. Hashtag love home ec. Me too, buddy.
And love you.
Yeah.
Okay, I just added 3 tablespoons of the applesauce and a little bit of vanilla. But to be honest, I don't always have vanilla on hand. Sometimes I just leave it out, and I also didn't measure it. Just a splash.
Yeah, it's fine. So just to let you know, we have our recipes printed out here.
Yes.
We don't know all of these things off the top of our head, so we're following along with recipes that we printed out. Normally when I'm meal prepping at home, I usually have my laptop open on the counter, or iPad, or my phone available, and I'm following a recipe to you, and I go back and forth.
Okay. So, we're just going to add the wet to the dry. And I love using like a big measuring cup like this, because then it saves you from washing extra measuring cups when you're measuring at your wedding.
Yeah, I take that for me.
Yeah, well, thank you. She's my assistant right now.
We know you don't have assistants at home. As nice as that would be.
Wouldn't it? So we mix this up. And then the next thing we're going to do is add our peanut butter. So it's about... Oh, yeah, her poor daughter.
I know, she's still kind of...
Just kids.
In her mind up there.
Sweet.
Okay. Yeah. So we were away for a long weekend, and so it kind of screwed up the schedule.
Right, my kids are very scheduled.
We also slept in the same bedroom as her for 3 nights, and so basically we have not slept. She's a good sleeper, but like kids, they move around, and she gets dreams, and she's...
But you look ravishing. She hasn't slept all weekend.
Okay.
So
a full cup of natural peanut butter.
A full cup of
So if you don't buy natural peanut butter, I know lots of people just buy regular old Kraft. What I would suggest is at least cutting the brown sugar in half. So instead of a half a cup, using a quarter cup. You still need a little bit in there.
Okay. Also, now my peanut butter jar is empty. Don't throw it out. I really like putting, if you make overnight oats, and I think we have a recipe on the blog, making it in the peanut butter jar, or even adding after you make hot oatmeal and eating it out of the peanut butter jar. It's a great way to get like a little peanut butter with every bite, and it's a great way to reduce waste, too.
Another good home economist tip. You should be a home economist.
I should.
Yeah.
I'll take it. Okay. Thank you. So we're going to mix that around, and this is great. It gives like swirls of peanut butter. You get a bit of peanut butter in every bite by doing it this way rather than mixing it into the wet ingredients.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I notice how when you cut your apple, like you're not taking the skin off those apples.
Never.
Apples bake really, really well with their skin on. what else can you substitute for those?
Pears.
Pears would be good.
You could do, we actually have a plum and almond butter baked oatmeal. You could do plum. You could leave out the apple too and just do this. You could throw in some raisins or some dried cranberries.
Yeah, which would be good too. I mean, apples are approaching the end of their seasonality right now. come summertime. Basically, these are stored apples from the fall because we're still buying Ontario apples. And so there are a few varieties left that you can still buy. But within the next couple of months, we won't have as many available in the grocery store.
Another reason I don't take the skin off is because I'm lazy. That's just another extra step. You don't. I never
exactly.
Take the skin off apples, pies, anything. Crisps. It's always on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Christina, hi. Thank you for joining us. We got a message from Wendy saying that the lighting was low. So I'm really sorry. I don't think we can do much about that today, but we'll see what we can do next time. We're happy at least finally Facebook Live has enabled us to go landscape, so you can see like both of us at the same time, and we don't have to just stand next to each other like this. Hey,
although
we're
I kind of like
this
that.
Is very natural.
But it is
so close.
I like being close. Okay.
I
should go. Okay. Enough talking. All right. We're going to be here for 2 hours, and it's past my bedtime.
Okay.
So we're going to add that.
Getting into the bowl.
In. And done.
Perfect.
We're going to put it in the oven. Set your timer for, it says 35 to 40 minutes. I think 40. We're going to do 40.
Yeah.
Because I think that's how long.
And if your oven hasn't preheated all the way till 350 in the last 10 minutes, it's fine. Just throw it in there anyway. Yeah. It'll be done in 40 minutes. Close enough.
Okay.
So we're going to switch spots. And I'm going to start on our next recipe, which is our tofu Thai coconut curry.
Mm-hmm.
And there's quite a bit of prep here to do. So hopefully I can stay on track. I didn't even grab a knife yet, but I have a cutting board here.
So we're off to a good start.
Okay, I need my recipe.
Okay.
My bowl, my ingredients.
But you're all doing the same thing now, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
We want to know, how long this takes you. If this is way too fast and you can't keep up, please let us know. The one thing that we did in advance was actually just wash our vegetables, and really it wasn't to save time, but it was more so that we didn't have to have our backs to you and wash veggies while we were doing it. So in this recipe, we've got a whole bunch of vegetables. The first thing I'm going to do is actually prep my tofu. So I've got a package of extra firm tofu here. Usually there's some liquid in these when you buy them. I've drained it out in the sink a little bit, but you can also just drain it out in your garbage bowl.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Darren and I were talking about this just beforehand, and she just takes the extra firm tofu and cuts it up as is. A lot of times what I'll do is I'll press it, and that's what a lot of recipes online will have you do. And paper towels.
I don't know where.
Oh, there's some over there on the table. I find that if you press the tofu a little bit, which means basically just wrapping it in some towels, either tea towels or some paper towels, and pressing it under something heavy, even for 5 minutes, will get a lot of the extra moisture out, and that allows it to absorb more flavor. It's totally unnecessary if you don't have the time. However, I can easily do that while I'm prepping the vegetables, and that's typically what I do. I'll just grab a heavy pot, put the tofu somewhere wrapped in towels, and then rest the pot on top, and let it sit there for a few minutes while it presses.
I just want to make sure we're not frozen.
Oh, go.
Because someone just said they're freezing. No, it's on.
Oh, we're
okay.
Okay, good.
Just the tofu. I never press it, and I don't notice. I personally don't notice much of a difference. I'm just lazy. I don't want to take the extra step. I just want to get to it.
Yeah.
Another note, we're not actually going to be cooking the curry today.
Oh, yes.
So we're just going to be prepping all the vegetables. So that means whether you want to eat it tomorrow or Wednesday or Thursday, all you have to do is really throw it in the pot and cook it.
Yeah.
And it's going to be fresh. Did you get your rice on?
No, I didn't.
Okay. We'll put the rice on.
Yeah, so I have a pot with some water in it. We're just going to boil the water. I'm making basmati rice with it. You can make whatever you like. If you like brown rice, mm-hmm. if you like quinoa, that's also a really good choice. It takes about 10 minutes once the water is boiling. So I'll also prep the rice and then just throw it in the fridge. So all I have to do is actually warm it up on the day that I want to eat it.
And then with rice too, if you normally make a cup, maybe make 2 cups so that you have leftover rice, you have an easy side dish for any meal during the week. Or I love throwing in rice or any grains into a salad. It adds some more bulk to it and really gives it a nice texture. So
yep.
I would do that with any grain. And same thing with the vegetables you're cutting. So Aaron's cutting
red pepper
right now. Maybe
yep.
you cut double that you need, so then you have extra red pepper for snacks or salads later on.
That's a good point. I bought extra green beans, and the recipe only calls for a handful of mushrooms, which is about a half a pack of the 225 gram packs. So I'll wash the rest. I'll have them prepped for some snacks later in the week. Same with the green beans. I'll snap the ends off of half of them, or off of all of them, and then save half of them for dipping in whatever dip or hummus that I have for the rest of the week. So mushrooms, going to do a quick slice.
Where are the comments coming up here?
Oh, so you have to be on the video?
I have to press play?
Sorry.
Yeah. This is normally Aaron's job.
I'm the tech girl. So just click
yeah.
onto it.
Oh, okay.
And then here. There we go.
Oh, okay.
Oh. Top. Yeah, what
sorry.
Does Devin say?
Sorry about that. Devin said, I would use the Amazon card to buy a tofu press. I've seen those.
Yeah, I have too.
I never used it though. I'm down with the books and cans, but I think I've reached a stage where I need... Pressing tofu is a key texture piece, especially if you're eating steak style. Yeah. Or for samis or bowls when it's not as sauced up.
Totally.
Freezing tofu is another way to play with its texture. I've actually done that before too, and when you freeze it, and then after when you're using it, it does soak up the sauce a little bit more.
Yeah, agreed. So all I'm doing to the green beans is they've previously been washed, as I said, but I'm just snapping the little end off that has the stem. And then you can either cut them or break them all in two, up to you. And then I'm going to save some of them for afterwards as well.
Marty says, what about peanut butter and chocolate baked oatmeal? That would be delicious.
Oh my gosh.
You could just add in like some cocoa powder and maybe a few chocolate chips.
Yeah, totally. Instead of fruit?
Yeah, we have peanut butter and bars on the blog. They are amazing, and I think they've been a really big hit. It's just peanut butter, chocolate chip, eggs. Basically, that's it, and some sweetener.
We made them in one of our videos. Is Ness asleep?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's my husband.
He settled
our daughter, Ness.
Hopefully.
Hopefully.
And children.
Well, she's off her game. She had like a nap at 3:30 today, which is basically like if you're a parent and your kid goes to bed at 6:30, you realize how big of a disaster that is. Way too close to bedtime. Okay, so these are the beans that I'm cutting up for the curry.
And then that whole container, you're just going to dump it in a pot. Everything goes in at the same time.
Exactly. I've got an eggplant here. Typically for this recipe, I would use a Japanese eggplant, which is the kind of skinnier variety of eggplant that you can buy at the grocery store. This is an Italian eggplant. Totally fine. It will work well in the recipe. I like the Japanese ones because they have a little bit less moisture. Mm. And they're just a little bit easier to prep, too. You can just cut them into rounds. I'm only going to use half this because it's kind of big.
It's a big one.
Yeah.
And you could substitute any vegetables that you want. So
absolutely.
You could do zucchini instead of the eggplant. You could do broccoli, cauliflower, carrots, any vegetables that you have on hand.
Yep. So everything is cut roughly into bite-sized pieces. If it's not perfect, then who really cares? Because it doesn't matter what it's like when it goes into your mouth.
And if you try to cut them roughly also the same size, just so they all cook at the same time, that would be helpful.
All of our veggies prepped for our tofu curry, so now I'm just going to cut up the tofu.
I'll just move those out of the way.
This could have used a bit more, some more paper towel, because there's still some moisture, but that's okay. It doesn't really matter. Again, like, it would still be delicious. This is how I cut my tofu. I don't know about you. I cut it in half this way first. Can you guys see this?
I do not cut it this way.
So that it makes perfect squares. I'm a little bit more anal about my...
About details?
Oh,
really?
Some would say. And then I cut it into thirds. And then I cut it into little squares.
That's actually way more efficient than the way I do it.
Yeah. So obviously the recipe that we have linked with the grocery list that we've also sent you will tell you how to cook this because since we're only prepping it today, but essentially you make the sauce, which we're going to make now ahead of time. And then you put in all the vegetables. The ones that we've chosen all cook for approximately the same amount of time. So you don't have to think about which ones need to go in first or last. They'll all roughly cook in about 10 minutes or so. And then you put the tofu in and boom, you're done. And then your rice is already ready as well.
So Devin says she's actually grown eggplant on her patio.
Oh.
Which is pretty cool. I
wonder how big they are.
I don't know, Devin.
I know, she lives in a condo, so... Okay, so that's not my recipe. This is?
We're just Aaron's
for the sauce.
Okay.
The sauce. We have a can of, in the recipe it actually calls for light coconut milk, but I never buy light because the only thing different between light and regular is water. So you're paying for water when you buy light coconut milk. If you want to add a little bit of extra water to the recipe, which it actually calls for, then just add a little bit of water. Don't pay for it when you buy coconut milk. Okay.
Devin also says she loves using the eggplant in our eggplant parm recipe.
Thank you.
I've made that a million times. I think Aaron has too. It's always a hit. It's that tomato sauce. It's so simple. It's just three ingredients. Butter, tomatoes, an onion, and a little bit of basil. So four. And it's so, so good. So if you haven't made that yet, definitely give that one a try too.
Half a cup of water. Totally eyeballed it just based on how big this can is. Good enough. The zest of one lime. Oh, this would be another good thing to buy with your Amazon gift card if you win, is a zester, or a micro, this is actually called a microplane. I think it's a brand name.
It's both of our favorite kitchen tools.
I love it.
Yeah.
It zests citrus beautifully. It's like this, I use this for ginger, so when I have ginger in a recipe, I freeze all my ginger, and this just like grates frozen ginger perfectly. Garlic, it works really well with.
Definitely buy one if you don't have one.
Yeah.
You can even grate some Parmesan cheese on it too.
Oh yeah, it makes really, really nice, mm-hmm. light, fluffy Parmesan mm-hmm. cheese too.
And this, you can just smell, like the lime zest also adds so much more flavor to a recipe than just the juice.
Yeah.
So anytime you see lime juice called for, just throw in the zest too. Because you can, it's going to add more limey flavor, and it smells so delicious in here just from that lime zest.
I'm using the juice with this, I think, too.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm going with the flow.
Yeah.
And then this, again, is just stored in the fridge. But you should see these pipes she's got up there. Yeah. Totally.
Okay. So I saw a tablespoon fish sauce. All right. So fish sauce is basically made from, I believe, anchovies. It's often used in Asian cooking,
mm-hmm.
And it's a really, really savory, salty flavor.
And it's good when you open it up. If you've never cooked with it before, it smells really funky. But don't let that turn you off.
Don't let the smell turn you off. It actually makes Thai curry specifically. Definitely. It calls for a tablespoon, and I don't have a tablespoon around, so I'm just going to... Okay, I think that's about right. Tablespoon of soy sauce. And again, if you are a vegetarian or vegan and you don't want to use fish sauce, double the soy sauce. Just mm-hmm. add an extra tablespoon.
I sometimes buy the light soy sauce, not light and... calories, light in salt,
yes.
The sodium one, because I find it, sometimes that one's just a little bit too salty for me. So you could also just cut back a little bit if that's the only one that you can find.
Yeah.
I do love that Kiko Man brand of soy sauce though.
Same
like that's
here.
That's the one
Kiko
that I
Man
buy.
Is my favorite.
It's so good. It's a different flavor than the other like regular brand soy sauce.
Yeah.
You can find that one adds a really different flavor.
I think it's like the more. I think it's like higher end soy, like so we're fancy.
Very classy over here.
High end soy sauce. How much of this?
Like a spoonful-ish.
I think it calls for a tablespoon of, how come I can't see paste? Mm-hmm.
A tablespoon.
Is it not in here?
Yeah, so, you know, we left out oats, and now there's, you know, there it is.
Oh,
tablespoons
right at the beginning.
Paste.
Okay.
You know, there was one
That's
recipe.
A lot. That's a lot. Okay, so I'm adding this much.
One recipe we had on our blog was for chicken fingers, and we go through the ingredients list, and everything's listed there, and you know, we forgot chicken. How much chicken? Obviously, chicken fingers, you need chicken.
And someone actually shared that recipe on their website, and they didn't catch it either.
So there you go.
They put it on their website, and someone from their website told them, by the way, there's no chicken in this recipe, or chicken fingers.
And a couple
of tablespoons of brown sugar. Which you could totally leave it out if you want this to be completely savory, but a little bit of sweetness, again, makes it a Thai curry.
And you could add white sugar too, you could add a little honey also,
yep.
just to add a little bit of that sweetness.
Exactly. So we're going to whisk this up, and this is just going to get covered with some plastic wrap, or if you had a Tupperware container for it,
mm-hmm.
you're all set. And this would be heated before you added the rest of your vegetables and your cookies.
Rhea now has lime juice and soy sauce in her eye. Her eye. Oh, apologies. Apologies, Rhea. Let me do Rhea there.
Okay.
And then that's it. So your curry's prepped and your sauce is ready and Aaron's dancing. And now we're going to move on to the Mexican lasagna. How are we doing on time? We're like really good. We're like 6 minutes ahead. Four minutes ahead.
Amazing.
Okay.
So if you have questions, like let's take our time. Let's just like
slow down.
Transition to the next one a little bit more slowly.
Just gonna clean up here.
Yeah, we'll just tidy up a little bit and we'll see if anyone else has questions. Okay. Really good to know. Good time. Inspiring. Thanks, guys. We have lots of people that are inspired to cook by us. That is really, really sweet.
Okay. So the next one we're gonna do is the vegetarian Mexican lasagna. So I'm just gonna get everything set up here. I need another 9x13 pan. And a red pepper, and your cheese. We're gonna try to clear out some of this mess.
Okay, we've got boiling water for the rice. Again, we're kind of doing teamwork here, which is not allowed and kind of not fair to you guys who are cooking by yourselves at home. However, okay, I'm just making about a cup of rice. I don't have plans.
Use it up
to
do anything else with rice this week, so I'm not making any extra. But Dara's tip is a really good one. Just make extra. Even if you don't know how
to make extra. It's also a good tip for any of these recipes. Like our baked oatmeal, that 9x13 pan makes like 10 to 12 servings.
It's huge, yeah.
So that might seem like a lot, but it also freezes really well, and you can just reheat it with a splash of milk in the microwave. It's also good for snacks, too. So you're looking for an extra snack during the week.
Yeah. It comes out kind of like a bar, almost, when you don't add
especially
extra
milk. Especially once it sits in the fridge for a little bit. And if you don't want to make that much, though, you could half it and just make it in an 8x8 pan, too.
Yeah.
Totally fine as well.
Yeah.
The same thing with the lasagna. We're doing it in a 9x13 pan. When I was, like, 35 weeks pregnant with my second daughter, I made this recipe. And when I was making it, I just doubled it. And I put a pan in the freezer so that later on, when the time was a little bit busy, we had dinner ready. So a good thing for meal prep is just whatever you're making, always double it. Because then you have lunches and leftovers for the week.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start on the vegetarian lasagna. So we're not going to bake it right now. We're going to, just like the curry, we're going to make it all. We're going to put it in the fridge. And then whenever you need it, you can bake it. Or you can freeze it if you don't want to eat it this week too. And it reheats really well. Yeah. So we're going to saute some spinach. I just used the bag of washed and ready to eat baby spinach because it's, again, really easy. I have a skillet back here. I don't know, Erin.
Oh, yes, we have child box.
I don't know how to open these. And I'm turning it. Oh, this opens.
You just open it like that. Okay.
We're just going to preheat it to like medium high.
Okay.
I'm going to just use a little bit of oil. You can use spray, whatever you want.
Wendy asked if there's coconut milk in the curry. Yes, there is. Sorry you missed that part. There is a can of regular coconut milk in the curry as well. You can mix that into the sauce with all the rest of the ingredients, and that's going to just kind of sit in the fridge until you're ready to make the curry later this week.
So I hope you can see. I'm just going to add the spinach to the pan. And just, it's going to really wilt down. It's going to look like you're adding a ton of spinach, and try not to get it everywhere like I'm doing.
I should have given you a bigger pot.
It's Erin's fault.
My bad.
And then you're just going to wait until it's wilted. So while that starts cooking down, I'm just going to take the black beans. So that's the next thing you need. And we're going to just drain and rinse them. So we're keeping this lasagna. Okay, again, Erin, is this like a childproof can opener?
Okay.
It's not great. No, I got it.
Sorry.
Okay. Next time I'm bringing my own equipment.
Yes.
We're keeping this vegetarian, but you could throw in, if you have leftover chicken, that would be great in this too. You could use any bean instead of this. Tofu. You could put tofu in this.
Tofu would be good too.
Yeah.
Or like the ground.
Fake ground meat,
it's called. It's like the fake ground beef. They have like a Mexican flavored one, I think.
I've never tried that actually.
Yeah, I don't remember if I have. But you know what? It works perfectly in dishes like this when there's lots of other flavors. It would be really good in this.
Mm-hmm.
So we're rinsing the black beans just to get rid of some of the liquid. We don't need it for the recipe. It also gets rid of a lot of the sodium in the beans.
So next thing I'm going to do is chop up a red pepper. You know what would have been nice if Erin saw that I was going to do this in the recipe? She was chopping pepper. She could have chopped it for me already. That would have been cheating, I guess, a little bit.
We totally chop peppers differently. Did you notice that?
I wasn't. I'm sorry, I wasn't.
No.
How do you chop it? You can tell me.
I cut mine in half, and then I like scoop out half of the core on one side and half of the core on the other.
It's interesting.
I think this is much faster.
Thank you.
Although your pieces aren't as square as mine.
And is it again detail? I'm just like, just chop this thing, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
Erin's getting it nice and perfect. Okay.
Karen's apple bake is going in. Nice, Karen.
Good job.
Yeah. We are going really fast, we realized. However, you'll get to pause. You can pause it if you want. I think you can pause. Can you pause on the live?
No, I would imagine not.
Oh, you can watch it after the fact as well if you miss something.
How's my spinach? It's okay. You could add also any other vegetables too. I'm using red peppers. You could use mushrooms, zucchini. You could leave out the vegetables and just do the sauce and the cheese. This recipe is also really good because it's kind of like enchiladas but not rolled. So you're taking out that step. It takes a lot less time to assemble.
Dara is also the queen of Mexican recipes on her website. The other day I was looking for, I forget what, Cinco de Mayo recipe.
I do love them. And I always wanted to go for Mexican.
Yeah.
And my husband says he doesn't like Mexican. That's a lie. He does. I don't know why he says he doesn't. I said, I always want to go. If anyone wants to go for Mexican with me.
I like tacos.
Okay, there you go. Tomorrow's Tuesday. Taco Tuesday.
Do you want me to do that?
No, because that's cheating.
I know it's cheating.
Okay, we're not cheating.
You know. So we're doing this in a really short. shallow, just like frying pan. One thing that you could do to speed this process up as well is we could have used that big red pot and covered it. And so the steam will actually wilt your spinach a little bit faster.
Really getting it everywhere.
That's
here.
Fine.
You could also use frozen chopped spinach. I would just make sure to drain out the water really, really well so that it doesn't make the lasagna extra watery.
Yeah.
But that you could use that too. I mean,
or kale.
Okay.
Disaster of fire kitchen over here.
Yeah. Hopefully the fire doesn't start. This is almost wilted.
Shauna's spinach is wilted and ready to go.
Well,
Shauna.
Aren't you
efficient?
You're a professional though.
She is. Shauna is our friend who is also a dietitian, and she does culinary workshop, so she really is an amazing cook and teaches people how to cook in her incredible home kitchen.
So while you're, if your spinach is in here a really long time, we're going to blame Aaron's stove, you can start grating your cheddar cheese. We're using the real stuff, old cheddar. It's delicious. And we're actually going to use, that's why we told you to buy a really big block, because we're also going to use it for snacks.
Snack prep.
You know, most of the snack recipes are mine, but Aaron at work is the queen of snacks, I would say.
You
bring really good snacks.
I do.
You pack good snacks.
Yeah, I would love to pack good snacks. It's, well, yeah, I mean,
who doesn't?
If you always have snacks in your house, it doesn't really matter if you have leftovers for lunch the next day, because at least you can just, like, you know, cobble together some a variety of snacks instead.
And like our last, if you check out our last Facebook Live, that was basically what it was. It was six really quick and easy kind of snacking type meals.
Yeah, exactly. And that's, you know what, like, I would say probably at least 3 or 4 days a week, that's what my daughter has for dinner. It's like a snack meal, like something like hummus and vegetables and yogurt and fruit cut up. Because she eats at like 5:30, and sometimes that's just when we're getting home from work and we don't have time.
So just if you can see this, it's wilted and it's going to keep cooking a little bit longer. So it's good. It's
you
good.
Can take it off the heat at that
point. Shauna, I'm done.
Yeah.
Okay. So the cheese, you want 1.5 cups of grated cheddar, but again, you don't have to measure it. You can just roughly eyeball it. As much cheese as you want, we're just using it to cover the top.
We had a question, the curry. Do we put the tofu in now or leave it? You leave it. You can store it in a separate, I actually stored it in a separate Tupperware container.
So you've got the veggies in one, the tofu in another, and then the sauce in another.
And so when you decide to make it, whatever, tomorrow, or Tuesday, Wednesday, you heat up the sauce, you add the veggies and the tofu, and then you heat up the rice and you're done. The meal should take you less than 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. I sprayed.
And
I put 13 pans.
Yeah.
So we're going to start layering. That's it. This is so easy. And it's really, really good. So I have a...
You can do it, dear.
I'm wearing a white shirt. I'm not...
Okay.
Pipes over there. So I'm using my favorite, just mild salsa, also whatever's on sale at the grocery store. I'm just going to add, it says like a third of a jar, so just eyeball it. Sure. And you just want to spread it around the bottom. You could use your favorite salsa. So if you like, you'd rather have a green salsa, use a green salsa. You could use enchilada sauce. Those would also be delicious here.
I think we have a recipe for homemade enchilada sauce.
Yeah.
Which is yours.
Yeah.
It's Mexican.
So it's yours. Okay. Really good. And now we're going to layer our tortillas. So I couldn't find corn tortillas. I prefer to use corn tortillas. I like the flavor and texture better, but whole wheat tortillas are also delicious. So we're using whole wheat tortillas. So you just want
to... I find corn ones difficult to find at the grocery store, too.
Totally.
But these are good. And how many will you use?
I'm going to use, I think, about 8. So we're going to have 2 left over, which is also great to keep on hand for snacks.
Oh, yeah. That was one of our 5-minute meals, I think, too.
It's
just using a whole wheat tortilla, putting some peanut butter, an apple, a banana, a half a banana in there, put some hummus in there. Like, again, it's just another thing to have on hand for a quick and easy snack or a quick and easy dinner if you need it.
So we're going to put another third of the salsa on top of the tortillas. So we're layering away here until they're all covered. If you were using corn tortillas, you're gonna need more than this because they're smaller. So I think we say 12. We told you 10 tortillas because they come in a package of 10. So that's what you're gonna buy.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to...
I smell this rice, I think it's done.
Layer. What did I say to come first? The spinach. See, I don't have these memorized.
No, okay. Who would?
Some people. Okay. So we'll put on the spinach. It's okay if it's still warm.
I'm going to drain this rice.
So just try to spread it out, I mean, I guess as evenly as possible, but it doesn't have to be perfect. You just want everyone to get delicious bites of all the ingredients in one. So, see, it's like a lasagna, but instead of the noodles, we have tortillas. Instead of the tomato sauce, we're using salsa, but we're definitely still using cheese. Okay. Careful.
Through my old hand.
And then next we're going to do the beans, so just sprinkle it on. A great thing, so if you wanted to make this kid-friendly, so if your kid's going to eat the lasagna and try to get them to eat the lasagna, that's great. I know for me, my kids will most likely eat something if it's all separated out and they get to choose what they eat. So to make sure you're all eating the same ingredients, just leave some extra beans on the side, a tortilla on the side, some pepper, some cheese, all the ingredients separate. And then they're eating the same thing as you, just it just looks a little bit differently.
Yeah, that's what we call being considerate without catering. So it ensures that you're not doing any short order cooking for your kids and that you're all sitting down to roughly the same meal.
Yeah, I think it's important that your kids see you eating the same food as them too. I think that models good behavior.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's a nice way to all eat together like that, not cooking five different meals. And
Yeah. Modeling good eating behavior is the best way to make kids kind of happy, healthy eaters, is eating what you want them to eat. Kids eat what their parents eat. If you look at examples from all over the world, you know, like if you look at kids growing up in India,
mm-hmm.
they're not necessarily eating what we would eat in North America, or being picky and having, you know, I don't know, like convenient, super
exactly.
convenient processed foods all the time, right?
You can see my pepper trap here, sorry.
Yeah.
What is this? Okay, but it's fine, right?
It's
like it doesn't matter. It's
yeah.
the same. Okay, so next is goat cheese. I love goat cheese. If you don't like goat cheese, because you used to not like goat cheese.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. I kind of just trained myself to like it, and now I really like it. I just kept trying it and trying it, because it was in so many things.
Yeah,
now I love it.
I love it, but you could use feta here. You could just use ricotta, really, too. It'd probably be fine. You could use mozzarella, cheddar. Like
you could just
anything.
Leave it out, because there's other cheese as well.
You could.
But more cheese is always
better. It wouldn't be as good, I'm telling you the truth. There, I don't think this would be so tasty without the cheese. But if you try it, let us know.
So how many days do you think this could sit before you should really bake it?
I would say maximum two.
Okay.
Like, I wouldn't let it sit. Like, we're going to have this tomorrow night. I wouldn't let this sit for longer than 2 days. I think the tortillas would get too mushy.
Too soggy.
You have cheese in there, too.
Yeah.
So if you're not going to eat this within 2 days, then just seal it really well. Put a label on the front when you made it, what it is, and just pop it in your freezer.
Yeah.
And then just let it come to room temperature and bake it.
You could thaw it overnight in the fridge.
Yeah, you could also bake it from frozen too.
Yeah.
If you don't have time or you forget or you're in a pinch and you want something to eat.
Yeah.
It'll just take a little longer. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sufficiently
Karen asked if feta would work, and yes, feta would totally work.
Yeah. You could also throw in, you know, if you're fancy, you could add in some cilantro or parsley or some extra herbs.
Yeah.
Now just a little bit of chili powder. I think it's like, I don't know what it is, one and a half teaspoons maybe. We'll just sprinkle it on top just to add that like familiar Mexican-y flavor.
Yep, you'll get some from the salsa,
mm-hmm.
some
this
from
just
that chili powder. If you have like pre-made taco seasoning packets, you can totally
yeah.
use that. That would be delicious.
And then you're layering again. So we're going to add another 4 tortillas, and then just sauce and cheese. And that's it.
Do you serve this with anything?
I would. Yeah, you probably would bring this for lunch, and that's a meal. I have 5 other courses. No. I would, we're going to have it, well, tomorrow night we're going to have it with asparagus, and probably with guacamole, because what's Mexican night without some guacamole,
yeah.
right?
But this is a totally complete meal.
It is.
This is what you had, and
I just like, you know, more variety at my meals. I brought dinner for Erin and her husband tonight because they were away
so
all
nice.
Weekend. They had, like, nothing to eat. They were exhausted, as you heard. So I brought them dinner, and her husband was like, oh, my God, it's such variety. That's just what, like, I like to have choices.
Yeah, it was so nice. Such a good friend.
Oh, wow.
We had nothing in our fridge, so
like, who knows what you'd be eating?
Nothing.
Okay. And cheese. Okay. And then that's it. Again, you could substitute any other cheese for this too. I would not leave this top cheese out.
Definitely not.
No.
Was there cheddar inside or just goat cheese?
No, just goat cheese.
Right.
I think it's enough. You could put cheddar inside. That would be really
yeah,
good.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I mean. Like, if you didn't like the goat cheese, you could kind of add a little bit of
you
extra
just,
cheddar
exactly.
and do one layer in there
yeah.
and one layer on top.
Done.
And so what would that bake at?
This is going to bake at 350 for about 25 minutes. And then you're going to take, so you're going to bake it covered, and then you're going to take off the foil and bake it for another 15 minutes so that the cheese gets nice and brown and bubbly.
For sure.
And if it's not brown enough for you, then you can broil it until it is.
I always like a couple minutes on the broiler, personally.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're going to cover it with foil now, though, and pop it in the fridge. And then that's done.
And that's it.
So now we're on to snacks.
So we don't really have any recipes, per se, planned out for snacks. We'll just do a little quick.
We're just going to tidy up.
We're going to tidy here.
It's funny how she's doing the snacks when you see all the recipes are mine, but Erin is really good at pre-portioning and preparing all of her snacks.
Yeah,
beforehand.
Yeah, it's an easy thing to do. I find that we're gonna be making our own fruit on the bottom yogurts. I've been doing this for years. I haven't bought individual yogurt cups unless we're on vacation or we need them for some reason. In a long time, because those things are too small.
They're really small.
There's not enough food in there. I'm hungrier than one yogurt cup.
And especially those silhouette sorts.
No.
If you look, it's like a spoonful and you're done.
Yeah.
Nothing.
So
we actually have a blog post where Erin shows exactly what she's going to show
exactly
you now. Exactly what she does.
I have a variety of these little tiny one cup Tupperwares, and this is what I put our yogurts in at the beginning of the week. I usually make 2 or 3 days at a time in advance. Often if I'm not doing meal prep on a Sunday, for whatever reason, maybe we went away for the weekend, when I make lunches on Monday morning, doing 6 or 5 or 6 at the same time takes the same amount of time as doing
Well, that's
two.
Exactly what we've been saying. Whatever
yeah.
you're doing, you just double it. Karen just asked, how long does the apple bake cook for? About 40 minutes.
About 40 minutes,
yeah.
Okay, so I have a random assortment of fruit. I got a new blender for Mother's Day.
No. What kind of blender?
I got a Vitamix, which is very generous of my 2-year-old daughter to have purchased. But so we're running out of frozen fruit. We always, always, always have frozen fruit in the house, mostly for these yogurts because I make them every week, but now for smoothies too. And frozen fruit is just a really great thing to have on hand for when fruit isn't all that seasonal.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, truthfully, there's not too much that's great at the grocery store to get that's seasonal. There's apples left still, and then you can get fruit from all over the world. But I just like to have it on hand.
We always have frozen berries in the freezer. I also always have frozen mango. That's a great snack just to eat from the package. Frozen mango
yes.
is delicious.
And the peaches I really like too.
Oh, I've never
you can
that.
Just take those out and thaw them at room temperature.
Yeah.
Actually, a friend asked me the other day because she had bought canned peaches and had thought that she bought them in water for her infant son. And she was like, oh, I bought them in juice or whatever.
Yeah.
Is it still okay? And it's still totally fine. But the best option would just be to buy frozen if you can't buy fresh.
Because
there's
just
nothing.
Frozen fruit. Exactly.
Exactly. So I've got some wild blueberries here, which just because it says wild blueberries, it doesn't mean they're actually going to pick them in the wild. It's a cultivated wild blueberry. I usually put about a half a cup of fruit. So you are not getting a half a cup of fruit in any
You're
kind
not getting
of...
real fruit in any of the
No, exactly. You may get a few chunks of strawberries or something. The other one I like is a berry blend. So we've got blackberries, strawberries, raspberries.
And you could, if you don't keep frozen fruit on hand, you could use fresh fruit in this too.
I do all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, when it's seasonal as well. I really like cut up mango and cut up strawberries. And then these are my absolute favorite is cherries. When it's sour cherry season, so those are the cherry pie cherries. Those are my favorite.
Get those frozen in the regular grocery
store? So I have not seen them in mine. Usually every year when it's sour cherry season, I buy a huge 10-kilogram bucket of them, and I freeze them in large freezer bag packages. Okay.
Jennifer Dick loves the yogurt tip. Thank you very much.
Also, if you're doing this for kids, and you're sending this in their lunch, you've got a refrigerator basically going into the cooler bag. So, the berries will keep your yogurt cool until lunchtime so that you don't have to feel like you need to refrigerate it. Okay.
Jammy says she uses frozen peaches and cottage cheese. So, if you don't eat yogurt, you could totally use cottage cheese
here.
That
is very grown up. I love it.
What kind of yogurt do you like to use there?
Lots of different varieties. So, We don't always buy plain yogurt. My husband and I both really like this Astro vanilla yogurt that is less sweet than most of the vanilla yogurts that we have that we try. It's also 4%, so it's delicious because it's got some fat in it, and it doesn't have gelatin in it. So if you're vegetarian, that's one of the it's a good option. Greek yogurt we'll buy as well, and if I want to sweeten it, what I'll do is just add a teaspoon or two of honey or maple syrup. If you can get yourself to the point where you don't need sweetener and you can just have plain yogurt and fruit, my daughter has never had sweetener in her yogurt, so she eats and loves plain yogurt. We still kind of want it and need it to like it, but yeah, totally up to you. So I've got a couple of containers here that are half full, so one of them, I'm going to put a little bit of Greek yogurt in some of them, and some of them are going to get the vanilla yogurt.
Yeah, we buy the Greek yogurt too. We buy the Greek vanilla. It is sweet, though. So
you can, well, you can also do like half and half, right? Yes. Buy a plain, buy a vanilla.
She's a friggin' genius. No, we don't do the half
science,
and half.
Science, man. Yeah. Simple math. Okay. yeah. So, how much time do we have here?
We're 8:48.
Okay.
We're
so I'll just fill this one, and then I'll fill the rest after.
And also, just the yogurt is really good to serve with the baked oatmeal, too. So if you have extra yogurt.
So good. This would be a perfect breakfast if you didn't want to bring it for lunch as well. And I'm touching it because these are for me. This isn't a commercial kitchen, and this is for me and my husband.
I was texting with Aaron before, and I forgot we were doing this. And then I got so excited knowing that I have dinner ready for tomorrow after our demo tonight.
Exactly.
It was really exciting.
This is just for you.
It's for us. Because this is what we do normally.
This is basically, so if I don't do this on a Sunday, sometimes if a weekend is really busy, I'll still do it on a Monday.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to be for every day of the week. Just covering one or two days a week with basic meal prep stuff, like, goes a really long way. Right?
And that's why we're doing two dinners here. When I plan my week, I don't normally plan seven dinners. The max I usually plan is three. We leave one for you're going out, or you're lazy, or you order in, or you have leftovers, or there is always a wing at night.
Yeah.
You don't have to think you have to be overwhelmed and plan for 7 days, all the meals, all the snacks.
Exactly. So otherwise, so this is really the only like major meal prep that I would do for a snack during the week, 2 or 3 days worth of yogurt. Otherwise, I'm going to use the leftover block of cheese that Dara brought, and I'm going to cut up some cheese. I mean, this would take 2 seconds during the week, but you know what? It takes less than 2 seconds if you already have it cut up, especially if you've got kids at home that are coming home really hungry, and you don't just want to throw them something that's less than healthful. When you have cheese cut up already ready to go in the fridge, it's a perfect snack. It's a really good filling, perfect snack. So I'm just cutting it into squares.
You could make it easier. I buy the cheese sticks too.
Yeah.
Like if you want to go and just buy the one step more convenient food, that's easy to
make. Totally
the cheese
fine.
Sticks.
Absolutely.
It's just cheese.
It's 100% cheese.
Yeah.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. This is just a good way to reduce waste by using your leftover cheese right away. You're using it when it's fresh. I would serve it. I would just keep it in the fridge. We always have whole grain crackers on hand. We mentioned this before, but I really like Triscuits. They're made from 100% whole grain wheat, oil, and salt. That's it. Three ingredients.
Mm-hmm.
Other things that I always have on hand for snacks, this would go with crackers as well. Hummus. We mentioned the leftover vegetables that we didn't cook with our curry, so the beans, there's some mushrooms, peppers.
Yeah.
I always have a bag of mini carrots on hand because there's absolutely no prep work involved.
Yeah, and just you buy a cucumber. It takes literally like 30 seconds. Wash it, slice it up. That's another good dipping option. And most kids generally like cucumbers, I find.
Yeah.
The baby tomatoes too, like the grape or the cherry tomatoes, you just have to wash them. That's it. So you have extra vegetables on hand for snacks.
Just have them ready to go. There's a few vegetables or fruits that you wouldn't wash before, one of them being berries that you wouldn't wash beforehand, that you wash at the last minute under water in a colander. But otherwise we can prep everything beforehand. It just makes your life so much easier. The last thing that I would do regularly, serving with cheese, just as a different option if you don't want crackers all the time, apple slices. What I'll do is wash my apples ahead of time and then slice them at the last minute. Or you can buy Arctic apples. Have you seen those?
I saw them. I was at the Canadian Produce Marketing Association trade show. Yeah, they had them there. They don't brown.
Yeah, it's a genetically engineered product that is Canadian. And they're now on the market, and it's when the apple, they've gotten rid of the enzyme that allows the apple to brown when it's exposed to oxygen. Mm-hmm. So you can pre-slice them at the beginning of the week and have them ready to go.
And if you do slice this apple, or you're just going to eat it a couple hours later, if you just drizzle on some lemon juice too, it will help it from getting brown. So
yeah.
You want to prep it a little bit ahead of time. Sometimes I do that.
Yep.
Because I just want to get things going.
Yep.
You can do that.
Yeah, I could have used the rest of my lime, actually. Lime juice would work well, too.
Yeah.
It's an acid. And, like, cut them up and put them in little bags.
Orange juice, anything you have on hand.
Yeah, that's perfect.
The baked oatmeal is, like, done, I think.
Yeah, we got the 1 minute.
So I'm just going to have...
Yeah.
A minute.
We just have to close this.
Okay,
get some out here. Okay. Here.
Thank you.
Ready to go?
Oh,
smells
delicious.
We did well. 50 minutes.
Are you guys all done? Tell us. How are you doing?
The Arctic apple.
Yes.
I'm using the wrong side of the apple. Don't do
that.
Oh,
some. Okay.
Yep.
Lady done. Babe. So if your baked oatmeal is coming out of the oven, it should be like slightly firm. It will give a little bit. It's done. It will just be like brown around the edges.
Perfect.
And then it's done. So you want to let it cool before you put it away in your fridge.
Yeah.
And then just cover it, put it in your fridge. Or before you put it away, you can take it one step further and just portion it out into containers already. So all you have to do tomorrow, she's like, look at
what. No, that's not what I was going to say. I was going to
eat
say,
some now.
Eat some now. Serve it with some ice cream. Nice and warm.
It will be really good. Yeah, you could do that. But we're talking meal prep.
Right.
So you can put it in little Tupperwares like that. All you have to do is pull it out, a little bit of splash of milk from the fridge or the freezer or whatever, and it's you've taken it one step further to be prepared for tomorrow and the rest of the week.
So we're going to split this pan, right?
Yep. Okay. She's like, you're not taking that whole thing home, are you? We're going to split the pan. Yeah,
exactly.
Don't worry about it.
Okay, so that concludes our meal preps. We've got two dinners. We've got baked oatmeal for the week ahead breakfast.
Snacks. We've got yogurt, we've cut up cheese, and whatever vegetables you have on hand. We bought extra apples. So we're set. We hope you guys liked this.
Yes.
We had fun.
We had a lot of fun. We really, let me just see if there's any more questions that we want to address on camera.
And just don't forget about our contest that Erin mentioned. So if you're eating, even if you're not doing meal prep, if you're eating any of these foods this week that we prepped, post a picture on Instagram or Facebook, and remember to tag us, how to eat on Instagram, and how to eat blog on Facebook.
Yeah.
And we'll announce a winner on Monday. Next Monday.
A lot of people really like the yogurt tips, which, yeah, especially around the frozen fruits, sending them in kids' lunches. It just gives you another option, because most kids really like yogurt. And, like, frozen fruit is like candy. Anyway, I digress. That is it for us.
We're done.
Okay.
So also stay tuned for our next regular edition of Facebook Live Food Demo. We're going to be coming to you Monday, June 12th. We try to do the first Monday of every month, but we both have some things. So it's going to be June 12th. Mark your calendars, 8 p.m., only 10 minutes. So you only get 10 minutes of us.
Yeah. We would love to hear, I don't know if you went over this because I was in my little warm zone commenting. So if I did, I'm really sorry, but we would really like to hear what we did well and what would work better for us to do this again next time. So we want to make your life easier. We want you to cook at home more for your family and use simple ingredients and not be intimidated by getting into the kitchen and cooking for your family, because we just feel it's such an important part of life and raising kids. And
I think the more you do it, the more comfortable you get,
yeah.
And the more you realize it's not so scary.
This is, you know, the way we meal prep and what we do to get where we are and how much we cook. It's been changes over years, right? Like, these small changes, like, we didn't automatically start doing three meal preps in one day and adding snacks and all this stuff. These are the small incremental changes that we've made over time. So if you can do one or two of these things and you're not into meal prep at all right now, just making these yogurts, that's step
that's
one.
It.
Once that becomes part of your routine, adding something else doesn't seem like such a big deal. So what I want to encourage is not to feel overwhelmed by having to do this all at once and every week. But if you can do one of these things, that's a really great step in the right direction. And we just want to make this process less intimidating for you.
Yeah, just little changes.
We want you to love food. We want your kids to love food.
That's it.
And
just relax about it.
Yeah.
And enjoy it. And share it with everyone.
Okay.
And invite us over. For fun. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Seriously, we just go on and on and on.
I know, I just have to go to bed. Okay.
Now we have to clean up, and so do you, unfortunately. That's part of it.
Yeah.
We're not going to record that part, but it was great being with you here, and we will see you in a couple of weeks.
Bye.
Okay, bye, guys.